Welcome to Beyond the Data. I'm Dr. Phoebe Thorpe, and here with me today is Dr. Peter Strebel from the WHO in Geneva. Thank you very much for joining us, Peter.
Thanks, Phoebe.
We're here to talk about measles and eliminating measles. Many Americans have never seen measles, but it happens in a lot of other places in the world. Can you tell our audience a little bit about the variability in measles across the world?
Yeah, sure. So I think it's important to recognize that measles manifests itself very differently depending on the underlying nutritional status of the child. Mm-hmm. So in the United States, where there's good nutrition, good access to health care, the complications are relatively rare, and often measles is transient, lasts about a week, fever, rash, sore eyes, cough, and the child gets better. However, of course, occasionally, so about 1 in 1,000 cases can get an inflammation of the brain, and probably 1 in 1 to 2,000 may actually die. So while severe complications are rare, they do occur. Mm-hmm. But the general perception among parents and even providers is that it's a relatively mild illness. Contrast that with a developing country setting, vitamin A deficiency, mm-hmm. protein energy malnutrition, where children are really malnourished. Here the picture's very different. Children get severe pneumonia on top of the measles, and the proportion who die can be as much as 1 in 10. So you're looking at 1 in 1,000, 1 in 5,000 in the US versus 1 in 10. Very different mm-hmm. disease, and so parents in the developing world really are fearful of measles. So a very different perception of risk if you're in an industrialized setting with good nutrition versus, you know, a much tougher socioeconomic setting.
They do say about measles, though, that a case anywhere means a case everywhere.
Right.
What can you say about that? Because that's an interesting saying.
Yeah. So this is the other thing that's really important. Measles is very infectious. Mm-hmm. And so in the pre-vaccine era, basically everybody got measles. You know, very rare to get to age 15 or 20 without having had measles. It's that infectious. And so as a result, if you have an outbreak, and for example, we have an outbreak now in Mongolia, mm-hmm. We've seen cases have occurred in the US as importations. So, and this is how easily measles spreads, because it's that infectious. The flip side is that for vaccination, basically all children must be vaccinated, because if 1 in 20 or 1 in 30 people in the population is not vaccinated, measles can get in and can still spread. So the level of immunity in the population, vaccination, has to be extremely high. And it's higher than pretty much any other vaccine-preventable disease. So that infectious capacity, the ability for a person who's, and also early on in measles, you're not symptomatic. You don't feel sick. So for 4 days before you get the rash, you feel fine. And you can travel around, but you can spread. Hence spread on airplanes, in public places. Mm-hmm. So the measles anywhere is a risk everywhere. Is a reality we face all the time.
That is very interesting, because that makes me wonder about what strategies you have to do, mm-hmm. because it almost sounds like you have to vaccinate everyone.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
And that's a hard goal to reach.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell me about some of the strategies that you know are working, and then maybe some of the areas that you're having difficulty making those strategies work?
Right. So our fundamental strategy is to vaccinate children as soon as they turn 12 months of age.
Mm-hmm.
That's in the US, for example, and that's because maternal protection wears off during the first months of life, and by about 9, 12 months, the infants are susceptible. So our primary strategy is on time mm-hmm. vaccination, with the first dose at 12 months here in the US, and then a second dose at school entry. And the timing is really important, because you can imagine if children are late or miss their dose, they build up in the population and there's a risk of outbreaks. And as I mentioned before, you need 1 in 20 susceptible and you can have an outbreak that continues to
spread. So when you say 1 in 20, you mean if there were say there were 100 children in the room and only 5 were not vaccinated, that would be enough to continue to spread it.
Correct. Correct.
Wow. Correct. 5 out of 100 is all
so,
you need.
So your program goal practically is all children, because you know, some children cannot get vaccinated because they're immune suppressed, for example. So those few. So programmatically, we really have to stress on-time routine vaccination with the first dose and with the second dose. This is really critical. Mm-hmm. And in the US, this really works well because you have the school entry check and very high coverage at that stage. In developing countries where programs are weaker, maybe only one in three or one in two children are getting vaccinated. So coverage can be quite low in some places. We use what we call a campaign strategy. Mm-hmm. So periodically, every 2 to 5 years, we'll do what you call a mass vaccination campaign, where you target children, you target all children, particularly those who've missed their routine vaccination. So even, let's say, 4 out of 5 children are getting routine vaccination. That's enough over a 3 to 4 year period to build up susceptibles. And so that's why we do what we call preventive campaigns. And then the sort of last strategy, the fallback strategy, is if you've missed them in routine, if you miss them in the campaigns and you have an outbreak, we do outbreak response vaccination just to kind of dampen the spread and reduce severe cases and deaths. So that's the basic sort of lineup of strategies.
Okay. And so the other thing that I've heard some today is about rubella. So tell me, why are they doing measles and rubella together?
Right, right. Well, here we've got a great opportunity because both diseases are manifest as fever and rash. Mm-hmm. So it's when you're doing, from a clinical point of view, or when you're doing surveillance, you look for children with fever and rash and you test them for both. The other big advantage is the vaccine comes in the same vial, in the same syringe. In fact, here in the US, all children are getting measles, mumps, and rubella, the sort of triple jab. So we really have a 2-for-1, or in some cases a 3-for-1 opportunity, that if you're going to vaccinate children against measles, you might as well do rubella, and if it's economically possible, mumps as well. Now, in the developing world, because mumps is less severe and also is not really eradicable, because you have the protection wears off over time. So internationally, the focus is really on combined measles rubella, because both are potentially eradicable, and of course this severe diseases, and the vaccine price is not that much more. Single antigen measles about 20 US cents per dose, and combined measles rubella is about 50 US cents a dose.
Okay.
So this is an incremental cost, but relatively small, when most of the cost actually is related to the delivery.
Getting the campaigns and logistics around it.
Logistics, getting the staffing, getting the cold chain in place. So yeah, our real focus now is a combined measles rubella effort in the industrializing the developing country world.
I heard you talk about the strategies that you use to work and some about the funding. Are there barriers that you would like to talk about?
Sure. So I think the situation with measles specifically has been, it's a little bit been in the shadow of polio eradication and international interest in introduction of new vaccines, such as vaccines against diarrhea and pneumonia. So the real investment over the last 5 or 10 years has been in those areas, and measles and rubella have been a bit overshadowed by those priorities. However, things are getting better, and Gavi, the Global Alliance for Vaccines and Immunization, has recently put forward nearly $700 million over the next 5 years to support measles and rubella vaccination. And so this is very welcome. The reality is, though, there's still a shortfall. We estimate roughly $1.4 billion US needed for the supplementary control activities between now and 2020. So Gavi's come up with nearly half of that. The measles rubella initiative has about $300 million. So there's a shortfall of about $370 million still for critical mass vaccination campaigns against measles and rubella between now and 2020.
Okay. So I think what I hear you saying is we, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, but we kind of know what works, but it's gathering the resources and putting them together and then moving forward on it.
I think here, this is a situation, the vaccines we have are fantastic. They really work, they're safe. Our real battle or our challenge is getting them used. And so this is where, you know, both the resources come are important, and I think also just the commitment within the countries to really take this up, particularly if they're war-torn, if they have other natural disasters. These sorts of settings are where you really get children who are unvaccinated, and measles is really a big risk.
Mm-hmm. One of the points that came out in the session today was that the WHO has set the goal that 5 out of the 6 regions would have the measles eliminated. That's pretty close to eradication. You tell me, and it was by 2020, you share a little bit your thoughts about that, how reachable that is? And
right. So firstly, there's what's called the Global Vaccine Action Plan, which sort of defines the global effort across all vaccines from 2011 to 2020. And in there, 5 of the 6 WHO regions are targeted to have eliminated measles and rubella. But in fact, all member states in the 6 WHO regions have individually established a target date for measles elimination on or before 2020. So from a biological point of view, if all the countries succeed at the same time, we have global eradication. So that's the technical biological stand, which, as the experience in the Americas shows us, this can be achieved. Mm-hmm. However, what's missing is real consensus and political commitment and financial commitment up front to go for global eradication now. Mm-hmm. So, and I think the reason is, obviously, we're still in the last stages of the battle with polio eradication. So I think people are very mindful of finishing that battle first. I think that's a critical point. And also then mustering enough financing up front, because for eradication of measles, it'd be very important to go fast and hard. Because what we learned from polio is if you drag this, if this goes on for a long time, it's very costly. It takes up a lot of time and resources. So just to make the point that we do not yet have a global eradication goal, but we do have individual member countries and the regions targeting elimination.
Thank you very much for joining us. I appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
And thank you for joining us, and we'll see you next time on Beyond the Data.